I would have difficulty with two more conservative appointments to the Supreme Court, but that's what we'd be looking at in a McCain administration. I'm also troubled by not what Senator McCain says, but what members of the party say, and it is permitted to be said such things as, well, you know that Mr. Obama is a Muslim. Well, the correct answer is he is not a Muslim. He's a Christian. He's always been a Christian. But the really right answer is, what if he is? Is there something wrong with being a Muslim in this country? The answer is no, that's not America. Is there something wrong with some 7-year-old Muslim American kid believing that he or she could be president? Yet I have heard senior members of my own party drop this suggestion. He's a Muslim and he might be associated with terrorists. This is not the way we should be doing it in America. I feel strongly about this particular point because of a picture I saw in a magazine. It was a photo essay about troops who were serving in Iraq and Afghanistan. And one picture at the tail end of this photo essay was of a mother in Arlington Cemetery. And she had her head on the headstone of her son's grave. And as the picture focused in, you could see the writing on the headstone. And it gave his awards, Purple Heart, Bronze Star, showed that he died in Iraq, gave his date of birth, date of death. He was 20 years old. And then at the very top of the headstone, it didn't have a Christian cross. It didn't have a Star of David. It had a crescent and a star of the Islamic faith. And his name was Karim Rashad Sultan Khan. And he was an American. He was born in New Jersey. He was 14 years old at the time of 9/11. And he waited until he can go serve his country, and he gave his life. Now, we have got to stop polarizing ourselves in this way. And John McCain is as non-discriminatory as anyone I know. But I'm troubled about the fact that within the party, we have these kinds of expressions. So when I look at all of this, and I think back to my Army career, we've got two individuals, either one of them, could be a good president. But which is the president that we need now? Which is the individual that serves the needs of the nation for the next period of time? And I come to the conclusion that because of his ability to inspire, because of the inclusive nature of his campaign, because he is reaching out all across America, because of who he is and his rhetorical abilities, and we have to take that into account, as well as his substance. He has both style and substance. He has met the standard of being a successful president, being an exceptional president. I think he is a transformational figure. He is a new generation coming into the world, onto the world stage, onto the American stage, and for that reason, I'll be voting for Senator Barack Obama.
Will you be campaigning for him as well?
I don't plan to. 2 weeks left, let them go at each other in the finest tradition, but I will be voting for him.
I can already anticipate some of the reaction to this. Let's begin with the charge that John McCain has continued to make against Barack Obama. You sit there as a man who served in Vietnam. You commanded a battalion of the 101st. You were chairman of the Joint Chiefs. You were a national security advisor and secretary of state. There is nothing in Barack Obama's history that nearly parallels any of the experiences that you've had. And while he has performed impressively in the context of a campaign, there's a vast difference between sitting in the Oval Office and making tough decisions and doing well on a campaign.
And he knows that. And I have watched him over the last 2 years as he has educated himself, as he has become very familiar with these issues. He speaks authoritatively. He speaks with great insight into the challenges we're facing of a military and political and economic nature. And he is surrounding himself, I'm confident, with people who will be able to give him the expertise that he at the moment does not have. And so I have watched an individual who has intellectual vigor and who dives deeply into issues and approaches issues with a very, very steady hand. And so I'm confident that he will be ready to take on these challenges on January 21st.
And you are fully aware that there will be some, how many, no one can say for sure, but there will be some who will say, this is an African-American, distinguished American, supporting another African-American because of race.
If I had only had that in mind, I could have done this 6, 8, 10 months ago. I really have been going back and forth between somebody I have the highest respect and regard for, John McCain, and somebody I was getting to know, Barack Obama. And it was only in the last couple of months that I settled on this. And I can't deny that it will be a historic event for an African-American to become president. And should that happen, all Americans should be proud, not just African Americans, but all Americans, that we have reached this point in our national history where such a thing could happen. It will also not only electrify our country, I think, it'll electrify the world.
You have some differences with Barack Obama. He has said that once he takes office, he wants to begin removing American troops from Iraq. Here's what you've had to say about that. I have found in my many years of service to set arbitrary dates that don't coincide with the situation on the ground or what actually is happening tends not to be a useful strategy. Arbitrary deadlines that are snatched out of the air and are based on some lunar calculation is not the way to run a military or strategic operation of this type. That was on February 10th of this year on CNN. Now that you have Barack Obama's ear in a new fashion, will you say to him, drop your idea of setting a deadline of some kind to pull the troops out of Iraq?
First of all, I think it's a great line, and thanks for pulling it up, and I believe that. But as I watch what's happening right now, the United States is negotiating an agreement with the Iraqi government that will call for most major combat operations to cease by next June and for American forces to start withdrawing to their bases. And that agreement will also provide for all American troops to be gone by 2011, but conditioned on the situation as it exists at that time. So there already is a timeline that's being developed between the Iraqis and the United States government. So I think whoever becomes the president, whether it's John McCain or whether it's Barack Obama, we're going to see a continued drawdown. And when, you know, which day so many troops come out or what units come out, that'll be determined by the commanders and the new president. But I think we are on a glide path to reducing our presence in Iraq over the next couple of years. Increasingly, this problem is going to be solved by the Iraqis. They're going to make the political decisions. Their security forces are going to take over. And they're going to have to create an environment of reconciliation where all the people can come together and make Iraq a much, much better place.
Let me go back to something that you raised just a moment ago, and that's William Ayer, as a former member of the Weatherman, who's now active in school issues in Illinois. He had some past association with Barack Obama. Wouldn't it have been more helpful for William Ayers to, on his own, to have renounced his own past? Here was a man who was a part of the most radical group that existed in America at a time when you were serving in Vietnam, targeting the Pentagon and the Capitol. He wrote a book about it that came out in 2001 on September 11th and said, we didn't bomb enough.
It's despicable. And I have no truck for William Ayers. I think what he did was despicable. And to continue to talk about it in 2001 is also despicable. But to suggest that because Mr. Barack Obama had some contacts of a very casual nature, or they sat on a educational board over time, is somehow connected to his thinking or his actions, I think is a terrible stretch. It's demagoguery.
I want to ask you about your own role in the decision to go to war in Iraq. Barack Obama has been critical of your appearance before the United Nations at that time. Bob Woodward has a new book out called The War Within. And here's what he had to say about Colin Powell and his place in the administration. Powell didn't think Iraq was a necessary war, and yet he had gone along in 100 ways, large and small. He had resisted at times, but had succumbed to the momentum and his own sense of deference, even obedience to the president. Perhaps more than anyone else in the administration, Powell had been the closer for the president's case on war, and then you were invited to appear before the Iraq study group. Why did we go into Iraq with so few people? Former Secretary of State James Baker asked. Colin just exploded at that point. Former Secretary of Defense William Perry recalled later. He unloaded. Former White House Chief of Staff Leon Panetta added, he was angry, he was mad as hell. Powell left the study group meeting. Baker turned to Panetta and said solemnly, he's the one guy who could have perhaps prevented this from happening.
If this were a dictatorship, it'd be a heck of a lot easier. Just so long as I'm the dictator.